This is going to be a really familiar scripture lesson for you. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" Jesus replied. "How do you read it?" The man answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your strength and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But the man wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him, went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring out oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you had.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." Jesus told him, "Go. So I love that parable. I also love the parable of the lost son who returns home. Those are my 2 favorites. I'm all curious. Can you finish this insurance jingle for me? Like a good neighbor. Y'all are watching too much TV. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. Growing up in my neighborhood, we were like free-range chicken. We ran the neighborhood, basically unattended from morning till night in the summer. Parents occasionally looked out to see if we were still alive, I guess. And they all counted on Nana Richardson, who lived at the house on the end on the corner, to make sure that we wouldn't get across the street. And if we got close to getting across the street, she would bring her 80-year-old, 4'11" self out and chase us down and shoo us away from the street until we got back into our territory. So parents kind of counted on her as a last stop effort for keeping us in the neighborhood. I think that's a good neighbor, right? That sounds like being a good neighbor. It's not a bad starting point. A good neighbor, State Farm says, is someone who is there for you. I'm hoping that Christians are better neighbors than an insurance company. Good neighbors might have a key to your house in case of an emergency. They might feed your dog if you're on vacation. And we're still working things out with our neighbor. You know, I had a little dog trouble last week, and we're still on that task. They might feed your dog for you if you're on vacation. Your kids might hang out there at their house if you're running some errands. That's a good neighbor. And if you're a good neighbor, you might do that in reverse for them, right? You might have a key to their house. You might feed their dog. You might watch their kids for a minute. So let me ask this, do you know your neighbor's names? Your actual, literal neighbor? Yes? Wayne, I see you up there, and I know your name. I know some of my neighbor's names. I don't know all of their names, but that seems kind of like the first line, doesn't it, of good neighborliness, to introduce ourselves? You know, we kind of had a breakdown in that in our culture a little bit. That effort of going next door, the fear of introducing ourselves. I encourage you, at the very most base level, if you don't know your neighbor's names, make it a goal this week to go say hi. That's it. Just say hi, introduce yourself, tell them you're their neighbor. In the most literal sense, at the simplest level, being a good neighbor is knowing the names of the people who live next door to us and striking up a friendship. At least as good as an insurance company, right? We can do neighborliness at least that good. Will you join with me in prayer? We ask, Lord God, that you would open our hearts that we might feel your presence. Open our minds that we might hear your wisdom for us. Open our hands that we might serve your people. By the power of your Holy Spirit, we have you so. Amen. Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. I'd like to suggest there are three levels of being a neighbor. Beginner, intermediate, and advanced. Beginner neighborliness is surface level, knowing your neighbors and being helpful in the community and the world. And all of these levels are important, okay? All of the levels are important. Yesterday, Frank and I were having lunch at Picara. Is that how you say it? Picara? Been corrected, okay. At Picara on Springfield and Prospect. And at the intersection outside our window, a police officer blocked one of the lanes of northbound traffic. And we kept looking, and we saw that some truck had dropped all of the sod off the back of it. So one of the lanes was full of sod that had, sod's all rolled up normally. Well, this was all unrolled sod. And so the officer was out there rolling it up. Next thing we knew, someone pulled into the bank that's there, hopped out, and went over and started helping the police officer. Then a neighbor came from up the way, and he had his gloves on. He came ready. He rolled up the sod, and they were putting it to the side. Before it was all said and done, there were three men who jumped into the action to help that police officer roll up the sod and clear the road. Those three men didn't have to help, did they? Everybody could have just driven on. But they did. They stopped what they were doing, and they went out, and they helped. They were good neighbors. Financial support of worthwhile ministries. Writing those checks. That's good neighboring. Volunteering with some of our local agencies is good neighboring. We have many people in the congregation who are good neighbors like this. Put your hands up if you put something on your yellow sheet and you're a good neighbor somewhere out in the community. You're helping somewhere. Thank you. Thank you. That's good neighboring. These are very important ways to be good neighbors. That's beginner level. At the intermediate level, though, and this is one of the things I'd like to encourage Christians to do better. We are good to help in the surface way. And I'd like to call us to actual relationships with the people that we're serving. All right, so that's where this is going to be headed. If you're going to tune out and think about lunch right now, you already know the gist of it. At the intermediate level, we start to form friendships with our neighbors. Perhaps we share a meal or some conversation. We get to know their stories, the names of their kids, the things they enjoy doing, where they're from, what they do or did for a living. Last week I talked about small groups as a place where we can be vulnerable and where we can be known. This week as we discuss neighbors, I'd like to suggest that we invest some of our faith energy in knowing the people we serve. As I thought about neighboring this week, it has occurred to me that our church family lives in a neighborhood, just like I live in a neighborhood, this church is in a neighborhood. And I think we could be better neighbors, right? We have a whole apartment building that backs up to our parking lot. Do we know any of their names? Have we said hello to any of the folks who live there? They're literally our neighbors, right? Good neighboring would indicate that we should be forming friendships with the people who live right there next to us. I'm hoping as we move forward together, we'll create opportunities to be good neighbors to the people in the apartments. And if God is speaking to you right now, saying, you know what? I have the courage to grab a friend and go knock on doors of that apartment building and say, hi, my name is, what's your name? Please tell me. If God calls you to a ministry like that, I encourage you and empower you to do that then, right? All right. I'd like for us to come up with other ways for us to be good neighbors to the people in the apartments. And you know who else we're neighbors to? There are lots of people who use this building. Did you know that? Can you think of some of the people who use this building? Who are some of the neighbors that come to this building? Parents and kids with the child care center. Scouts. Yes, who else? Oh, I can't hear you all at once. Minds in Motion, yes? Basketball teams. What? We don't have a soccer team yet. But that's a good idea. Someone have an idea over here? their children here and entrust their children into our care every day? Did we introduce ourselves to the scouts who were selling popcorn last week? Have we ever volunteered to work with the Cubs Boy Scouts that are in the building? And they're a lively group on Monday nights. Right, Monday nights?
Yes.
Share. All right, so how can we be good neighbors to the people in our building? That's our next step, right? The people who are close by. Our upcoming community meal and trunk or treat on October 27th is an opportunity for us to get to know our neighbors. We'll have an opportunity to meet people, eat with them, and talk to them. Maybe you don't want to decorate a trunk, but you can certainly be a table host. You can sit for 2 hours at a table, right? You can come and sit for 2 hours at a table and introduce yourself to everybody who sits and eats with you that night. Some of them may be from the child care center, some of them may be from the neighborhood. I saw the sign out front. We've invited the entire community to come to a meal. We need people at those tables from this church saying, hi, we're glad you're here. Welcome. Good neighbors. So if you don't have that on your calendar, I'd like you to put it there, because I think this is one of those all hands on deck moments, right? Where our church family pours out and reaches the community and welcomes them. We want to create regular opportunities to build these kinds of relationships. As you think about this and dream about this and vision for our future, what things can we be doing that would help us to create friendships with our neighbors? At the beginner level, we introduce ourselves and get to know the names of our neighbors. Low risk, we keep a little bit of a distance. At the intermediate level, we are more invested. We share our story and we hear other people's story. We spend time getting to know our neighbors. The advanced level of being a neighbor is bigger, harder, and scarier. Jesus tells the story of someone who was at the advanced level of being a neighbor. And it's hard to hear this story. It's so familiar, right? Everyone knows this story. It's hard to hear this and grasp how landscape-altering this is. A priest, a Levite, a Samaritan, those aren't words we really use. So let me tell you the story in a fresh way that I hope conveys what Jesus was saying. And Don Byler, I'm apologizing in advance. Where are you sitting? Well, where is she? She didn't say, well, I'm going to pick someone else then. Trudy Walters, you're up next. A homeless Christian woman was traveling alone through the city when she was attacked by robbers. They stripped her of her clothes, beat her, and went away, leaving her half dead. Julia Malgreen, a Methodist minister, happened to be going down the same road, was probably running late to a meeting, and when she saw the woman, she passed by on the other side. So too, Trudy Walters, the leader in her church, when she came to the place and saw her, passed by on the other side. But an atheist, as he traveled, came where the woman was, and when he saw her, he took pity on her. He went to her and bandaged her wounds, putting on oil and wine. Then he put the woman on his own donkey, brought her to an inn, and took care of her. The next day, he took out his credit card and gave it to the innkeeper. Look after her, he said. And when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. The story Jesus told is about religious people walking past one of their own. And even more surprising than this story is the person elevated, the person who got it right, in the Jewish mind, was the enemy Samaritan. You hear how this shifts the world under our feet? The Samaritans were despised by Jews, and their practice of faith was considered dead wrong. I think atheists have got it wrong. Jesus is telling a story that reminds us all the doctrine in the world can't save us. You can be right about your Christology and your theology. You can have everything right about that. If you don't have compassion and generosity and love in the world right, you have missed the entire point. All right? The one who inherits eternal life in this story isn't the good and faithful person, but the one who had faith all wrong. Advanced neighborliness takes risks for the other person, even if they behave differently, look differently, or act differently. When you opened Austin's Place 13 years ago, you took a risk. It's a risky population. You saw a need in the community, and this is an emergency women's shelter that is housed in this church in the winter months. You saw a need in the community, and you opened your doors to strangers in need. I bet there were some people that thought that was a terrible idea. Right? those people? To me, it looks like being a good neighbor, advanced style. I'm looking forward to taking volunteer training with Austin's Place on Thursday night. There's another class on Saturday morning. I encourage you, if you haven't been a volunteer for Austin's Place, this is the year. Come and join me on Thursday night and take the training. Or come Saturday morning if that's a better time for you. I want to be able to meet these neighbors, the women who sleep in our emergency shelter. I want to hear their stories, because life is harder than we can imagine for many people. I want to get to know their names and to begin to build a relationship with them. I want to be a good neighbor to them, past the superficial. I want to take that next step, actually just to intermediate level, right? There was some big news released about Austin's Place this week. Did you see it? Were you surprised? Had you heard that it was coming this way? So Austin's Place is going to be leaving Champaign first at the end of this season. Women needing emergency shelter will be housed to see you at home, and they will be given year-round shelter with showers and laundry. The good work begun here at Champaign First will continue as Austin's Place moves to a new home. And I'm going to tell you what I saw in the paper article. They had 600 people who donated $48 a month. They would be able to cover the cost for the men's and women's shelter for the year. 600 people who commit $40 a month will enable them financially to meet their goals of providing shelter for the most vulnerable. That seems like a worthy call on our hearts and on our wallets. What must we do to inherit eternal life? Jesus answered, you know the answer. Love God. I know it's hard to get the order right, but you can't get it wrong. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. When asked who his neighbor was, what did Jesus do? He told a story about a good Samaritan. A risk-taking person with compassion towards someone he wouldn't normally interact with. He concluded the story with this. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. And how do you remember what Jesus said to that? Go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. Show mercy to those who are hurting. Show mercy to those who are lost. Show mercy to the neighbors you haven't met yet. Show mercy. I encourage you to examine your heart and your neighborliness. Are you a good neighbor? What level of neighbor are you? Are you ready to take it to the next level? Will you invest your heart, your time, your wealth, and yourself to know and care for your neighbor? Like a good neighbor, followers of Jesus Christ. For the strength you give and the courage you give and the abundance you have blessed us with, give us eyes to see our neighbor. Give us courage to introduce ourselves. Help us to know one another. Give to us great ideas for meeting and forming friendships with our neighbors in the apartment building and the neighbors who are in our building. And Lord, open our eyes to the next risk-taking mission you'd like to give us. We will be where you follow. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Ourselves and our gifts to God.
You may be seated. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of thee. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from willful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, God Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Your Spirit anointed him. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant of water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this as often as you receive it in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and with your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now. And now, with the confidence of children, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
Amen.